Okay, because Google did a thing where I had to re-verify my Google account and all this shit like that before I could actually start the broadcast. So hopefully that doesn't mess things up. But oh yeah, so it's not even at the Seattle Convention Hall. It's the Seattle Center Exhibition Hall. About for people just tuning in, not starting the podcast right now. We're broadcasting, but we haven't started recording. I'm just looking up the details of BrickCon 2014, which is a logo convention Annie's thinking about going to next weekend.
Yeah, if I'm not exhausted by
Yeah.
all my hosting duties.
Would Foley want to go up there?
She would tolerate my enthusiasm.
That's not too bad. $9 per person. Where the hell is the Seattle Center?
It's right next to the EMP, and
Oh, it is right there.
yeah.
Oh yeah, look at that. So it's really easy to get to and everything. Would you guys just like drive down there, drive up there in the morning, go to it, and drive back like later in the evening, or would you stay overnight?
That's kind of the plan. We may stay overnight. I don't know. That may be spending too much money, though.
Yeah, I was gonna say that hotel room. Maybe the deal breaker. Although there shouldn't be that much in the way of conventions or anything going on right now, so it shouldn't be like a hotel room. If you just wanted to like stay at the Motel 6, as
After
erotic as that would be.
Bill, after a month of eating out, breakfast, lunch, and dinner
Oh man,
with
that's not too
guests,
good.
I am broke. I am
Oh,
broke. Ugh.
man, I made some beef stew this week.
Yeah.
So I fried up a rasher of bacon, degreased it as much as possible because you want the flavor of the bacon, but you don't want the grease. Then fried up, this is all Maxwell Motley's frying pan that you got me. Fried up a thing of onions and mushrooms. Oh man, that was just a good base for beef stew. Then I threw in the beef and everything else. Pretty much fried everything before actually putting into the beef stew. Except for the vegetables, the carrots and celery, man, it was a good fucking batch of beef stew. That's pretty much what I'm eating for the next like 2 days.
Yeah.
Oh man, this is good shit.
I have finished ingesting my muffin, so I'm ready to go when you are, my
Okay,
friend.
I'll tweet about it too from my personal Twitter account. We can start recording. We can do the whole timing thing. Okay. Yeah, whenever you're ready to start, we can time the recording stuff. Yeah.
All right,
Okay. One, two,
so.
three, record whenever you're ready for that.
Okay. One, two, three, record. All right.
Yes!
And then let me know when you're ready for me to do my clapping thing.
Okay, one. Okay, go ahead.
One, two, three.
Okay, close. And so just say something into the
Yabba dabba dabba doo, yabba dabba dabba doo, yabba dabba doo.
Okay, that's all I really need. Just 15 seconds in. Yes! Okay, so I am recording, and we could start today's episode. Was that last week the first episode we just flat out missed?
You would know better than I would, because I usually miss them, and
Yeah, because I usually do the
you
fillers, but
keep calm and carry
last week
on.
got so bungled that, like, yeah. Anyway, we'll start the episode, and then we'll start talking
I
right
don't
now.
think so. I think we've straight up skipped week before, but anyway.
Yeah, maybe once or twice, but that was a pretty goddamn rare occasion where we just like biffed a week.
All right, good morning, friends, and welcome to the Boy Howdy Podcast. I'm Annie.
Good morning. Wait, who am I? I'm Bill. I'm sorry, we skipped last week, so I'm out of practice already.
That's right. We've already forgotten how to do this. So sorry, friends. We missed last week's podcast. It was a lot of things happened all at once. We had friend of the podcast Maxwell Motley visiting from sunny England. Had a lovely time with her.
Spectacular fucking sweetheart.
Yeah, it
Okay,
was a lot of
get
fun to have
over how
her.
nice she was.
Yeah,
And we knew she was a nice person, but like, she brought me a rubbing of the Peter Pan gravestone in Kensington Gardens, and like a drawing and a wooden thing, like a wooden little postcard.
She's a gentleman and a scholar. She's
And
good at
she
that way.
made a s how do you pronounce it? We call them scones.
She called them scones because she made
Scones.
us
Scones.
scones.
She made savory scones with Marmite, and then she made sweet scones with strawberry bon marmar, bon mama, whatever that French preserve stuff was, which was so good. I went out and actually bought some more. Because I'm not actually a big fan of, like, pastries and stuff like that. But I thought, well, maybe the magic's in the bon mamar.
Yeah.
Or Basso Moore, just in case. Like, if we ever have biscuits or toast in the house, at least I'll have, like, I didn't want to forget what brand of stuff that she bought because it was so good. And she was like, she was fucking fantastic. It was really cute.
Yeah, we had a cultural exchange. We ordered pizza and had hot wings, and she made us beans on toast.
Yeah.
So.
Well, technically, I made the beans on toast, but she supervised, like, the mixture of, like, the Tillamook cheddar in the beans. Because, like, see, when I've made beans and toast before myself, I just took the, it was a can of Blue Heinz beans, and just, like, heated it up and put it on the toast. She was very specific about how you have to mix pepper and cheddar cheese into the beans when you heat it, so it becomes, like, this gooey thing. It's not just the beans on toast. It's just beans and cheddar, and it's got to get some extra body to it. So we did that. That was actually pretty good, too.
Mm-hmm,
but,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, I had a good time. That was, like, man.
Yeah, Mexico sweetheart. She left, and Foley and I were kind of like, so when's she coming back? It's just a good egg. Foley made her watch a lot of Teen Wolf, so sorry, Max, that we've made you fall down.
Well, I was joking with her that she got the quintessential Bill and Annie experience in that, like, when we weren't at the convention, we were just, like, watching TV with her.
Yep.
Yeah, which that's how we spent all of our time. Because when she was over here, we watched a whole bunch of clips of, there's a lady on YouTube named Siobhan Thompson who has this, like, I think it's a YouTube series called Anglophenia, where she talks about, like, British culture and stuff, and so we watched a whole bunch of that. And yeah, poor Max, she spent a whole day forced to explain all this basic cultural stuff from the UK to me. And it was good. I got to learn all about you know, the McGann brothers and different British foods and stuff. But yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah, she, Billy, you'll be excited to know here that we went to go see the movie Maze Runner. We made her go see it with us.
Why
and,
Maze Runner?
Because the star of it is our favorite character from Teen Wolf.
Is it
Dylan
Styles?
It's Styles, yeah. So they're like, he's a very good flailer, so we wanted to see if they took advantage of his abilities, and they did. He flailed admirably in the movie.
Did they get to the middle of the maze?
They run the maze like, whoa, Bill, you wouldn't believe it. But anyway, before that, during the pre-movie advertisements, they had a spot for a show that's on ABC called Forever. That's Ewan Griffith, is this dude who cannot die, and his experiences through time, and he is now a forensic scientist in New York City.
Are they trying to follow that, like, Sleepy Hollow money? Because it's a guy who's, like, dislodged from time in New York, solving crimes and stuff? Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. But anyway, so both Max and I are both like, Ewan Griffith, Ewan Griffith! And Foley's just like, who's Ewan Griffith? So we made her watch the first episode of Hornblower.
Yeah.
So, and she had a good time.
Foley's not the world's biggest fan of the Fantastic Four movies just a couple years ago that everyone hated. Because Mr. Fantastic?
He was Mr. Fantastic, bless him.
Yeah, that poor son of a bitch.
He was a little too soon. Hey, you know what? Everything worked out just fine for Chris Evans, so maybe there's a chance still for Ewan Griffith.
Oh, that's right, I forgot Chris Evans, the guy who plays Captain America. He was Johnny Storm in that?
He was.
Because I remember he was the best part of, well, I never saw the second movie, but he was definitely the best part of the first one. Yeah. I forgot that, like, because it's funny that Captain America is so stoic. And but it's funny to think that he was actually started off as, like, you know, like one of the better kind of, like, asshole comic book characters in one of those movies. Yeah, okay.
Bless. But anyway, yeah, we got our Hornblower on. It was very enjoyable. Fully really liked it. So I don't know if she realizes that by committing to watching Hornblower, she's committed to, like, 18 hours of miniseries television. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
do you guys have the box set of Hornblower, or did I just give you some digital files?
I just streamed it online.
Oh, okay, so. Yeah, because I have the box set, but... Well, did you not buy the box set and you gave it to me?
Possibly, that sounds familiar.
Because then I ripped the DVDs from the box set, and that's how I have the digital files, so if you ever need those files back, essentially it's your box set I would just be giving back to you in, like, you know, iTunes form, but anyway, you know, we're talking about the Horatio Hornblower miniseries that came out maybe about a decade ago?
It was the first episode aired in the early 90s, and these were...
Oh, is that what it was?
Yeah, or excuse me, in the late 90s, I should say, I think 1997, 1999, and Ewan Griffith plays Horatio Hornblower, which is a character from a series of books, actually. And he's just great. He's very stalwart. Jamie Bamber plays his pining bro. What was interesting was, so watching Horatio Hornblower and having seen Maze Runner was very interesting because those are both ultimately book based off of books that are oriented towards young men. And it's all like they're basically the driving theme is like being your own man and being curious and being intellectually brave and like you know, self-determination and standing apart and standing alone and being kind to others but still being a self-reliant dude.
Yeah.
It's just, it was just interesting because both Maze Runner and Horatio Hornblower kind of turned those concepts up to 11. And everyone was saying that Maze Runner is Hunger Games for boys, and it's really interesting because it's more like a utopian Lord of the Flies sort of thing is the best way I can describe it.
Is Maze Runner not just the American Indian sequel to Blade Runner?
It's a really rough joke there, Bill. You should workshop that a little more. No, Maze Runner is just about this. These kids live in a glade. They call themselves Gladers.
Gladers.
Those who live in the glade. And then there's this whole, I told Foley afterwards, I'm like, this is just Nowners, the movie, because they're like, oh, if you go to the maze to be a runner, you know, it's like, here's the others. It was just interesting.
Picture this guy going up to, like, this old weather cop going up to this kid who looks like Atreyu from the Neverending Story and says, we need you, Atreyu. We need that old Maze Runner magic. And the guy worked at a farm where they sell pumpkins in the fall.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, we need you to hunt down this pumpkin stealer.
Bill, I'm just saying, you should watch Maze Runner because it looks just like a weird adaptation of Pan.
Yeah, you know what? I had no idea that movie came out. Like, I saw last spring, I saw something in the 20, like in the that thing they show before they even start showing the trailers at the movie theater was like the Maze Runners. Like, this is, they were essentially saying like this is the new this. They were marketing it as this is the Hunger Games if you have a penis.
Yeah,
and that's all I remember because they were talking about like the design of the maze was different than what it is in the books, but that made it much more cinematic and stuff. But we're spending way too much time talking about Maze Runner.
Well, no, where I'm going is it's really interesting because to compare it to Hunger Games because ultimately Katniss and Hunger Games is what?
I just thought of the obvious joke that instead of calling it Hornblower, to tie it into the Maze Runner thing, we should be calling it Cornblower because of Maze Runner.
Oh, God, I just got your joke. Okay, I didn't understand where you were going with the Native American thing either, and now I get it. Maze with an I.
I'm sorry, you were going to make a profound statement about, okay, yeah, what?
My coffee is still kicking in here. So anyway, but no, Hunger Games is ultimately about protecting people you love.
Yeah.
Like, being strong for others. Whereas, you know, Hornblower and Maze Runner both have elements of protecting others, but it's really more about self-reliance and being your own person. It's a very interesting contrast. Yeah. So anyway, that's my deep, insightful commentary on this movie you don't see and have no interest in. But yeah, Hornblower is a lot of fun. I forgot. It's been a long time. I think actually since I first moved to Portland and we watched it.
Yeah, it's been about 10 years since I really sat down and watched it, too. I'm kind of wondering how it ages.
It's very slow, but it's actually still pretty
good. No, but it is Hornblower. I mean, there's battles and stuff like that, but it is still kind of just like, kind of, you know, it's a drama, though. So it's still, you know, there's a lot of downtime between, like, the big battles and stuff. But yeah, Yoan Griffith is really good. Like,
yeah,
Paul McGann's in that? What the hell did Paul McGann play in Hornblower?
Who's Paul McGann?
He played one of the doctors, like for the American TV show. Oh, anyway, I'm being distracted.
Oh, he plays Turd Machine, doesn't he?
What's Does he play name? Turd Machine? It's so weird they have a character named Turd Machine. He's the captain of the French ship. Turd Machine.
He plays. Wait, no.
Mad Machine. Excuse me. Machine.
I was trying to remember.
Anyway, what else happened? So this is us just saying, Maxwell Motley, listener, friend of the podcast. No longer a friend of the podcast, but just friend of ours.
Mm-hmm. Burr, burr,
burr. I bought her a bunch of macaroons for the trip back to the UK, and she ate them for breakfast. And I've never had macaroons before, but it was funny just to see her eat a shitload of macaroons before getting on the airplane. It seemed like a weirdly appropriate Bill going away thing of like, here's 5 pounds of cookies. Eat this for breakfast before leaving America. So that's why I got to say goodbye to Maxwell Motley.
See, Max was in town to visit and also to help Bill out at his booth during the Rose City Comic Con, which was the weekend before last.
And by help Bill out is, like, help kind of tolerate Bill's super ghetto booth, because Bill didn't think about, like, decorating his booth until he actually showed up at the convention. I had the most ghetto booth at Rose City Comic Con.
Bill, I roamed that call. You did not.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, because I had little handwritten signs and shit, like, hanging with duct tape and stuff. It was pretty Mad Max. What'd you guys think of the Rose City Comic Con?
I always have a good time. It's, you know, it's a fun show. They do, generally speaking, they do a pretty good job of keeping kind of the resellers and more pop culture-oriented stuff, like, a little bit separate from the comic stuff.
Or yeah, there is a resellers ghetto. So, for people who don't know, just quick background, Rose City Comic Con is Portland's relatively brand new mainstream Comic Con. I think this is the third year, and because in the past there were only two other conventions, really big conventions in Portland, and one was the Portland just comic book convention, but that was mostly resellers and stuff. What I kept on hearing from people, it really was just like almost like a yard sale. And then you had the Stumptown Comics Fest, which me and Annie had been part of and been at a whole bunch, which is the indie comic scene. And so, the Rose City Comic Con is put on by the same people who do the Emerald City Comic Con, which is one of the bigger cons in the country. And it's mainstream. It's more mainstream where they have, you know, TV guests and movie stars and shitloads of people in cosplay and stuff. It was a good time.
Man, before I even made it into the convention center, I had seen no less than 6 children in cosplay.
Yeah.
3 of whom were tiny female Matt Smith Doctor Who's.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, we were walking from the parking garage. Well, this is also one of the nice things, too, is the first thing we saw when we got off the elevator was a sign saying, you know, it's like costumes aren't consent or whatever.
Yeah.
And so they were really good about, like, trying to make everyone seem kind of all-inclusive. And so it seemed to be a good crowd. There were a lot of ladies there, a lot of people who weren't just white dudes.
Yeah.
It was everyone was talking about how the sales, people who were exhibiting at Rose City this year said the sales weren't all that great, despite the fact there were tons of people there.
Yeah.
But it was really worth it just to go, at least from my perspective, just to people watch. The cosplay was nuts. It was fantastic.
Yeah, there was a 2-scale Lego R2-D2 beeping around.
Mm-hmm. With, like, sounds coming out and stuff. Like, it's funny because when I first saw it from far away, I thought it was just a poorly built R2-D2. And you get up and it's like, oh no, it's just made out of Lego. It's supposed to look like this. Which looked good for a Lego R2-D2.
I have one regret, which is that I did not take a photo series of Foley looking flustered around amazing lady cosplayers.
Yeah, because you did the one photo thing.
I took a picture with a bunch of Viper pilots from Battlestar Galactica. That was Foley so happy. But they're, like, Foley kept, I kept seeing her brain reboot. Like, she saw one really good Lady Thor, but the one that really got her was, there was one lady who was dressed like, kind of more SWAT-dressed Catwoman from the more recent comics.
Oh, really?
Except she had long hair, whereas in the comics, it's short hair. And this woman was, like, 6'2". She was awesome. And Foley just, like, saw her walk by, and I saw her brain just, like, go,
if you're a human being with any kind of sex drive, a lot of that cosplay, yeah, there was, like, regardless of what your sexual inclination was, there was a lot of, like,
not even, like sexually speaking, it's just, like, oh,
no,
man,
it was, like, so good cosplay, but, like, says the guy who was just congratulating convention for having a, you know, cosplay, not because I'm like, oh, yeah, it was a boner convention.
But it was really great. One of my favorite costumes of the show was there were 5 people dressed like the Flash, and then they did Flash in motion. So, like, they did all these poses where they were all just, like, a little bit down the scale. It was really, really good.
Yeah.
It was a fun show. It was a good show. I got to, oh, man. So one interesting highlight of the convention for us was we went to go see one of our favorite artists, Claire Hummel, also known as Shumla online. And she's a really swell artist, a big fan of hers, and we got her art books, and we also asked her to, we commissioned her to do a drawing of Asami from Legend of Korra for us.
Oh yeah, I saw that.
And, but while we were there, we saw in real time a dude walk up to her booth, discover her for the first time, wow, you're really good, and right away go, you should draw my comic. You know, I have this comic I've been working on ever since I was a teenager, you know.
So this guy was probably going from booth to booth all day.
He's just like, you know, it's really important to me. It's kind of like my passion project. I haven't actually written any of it, but I have like some biographies and like maybe you can, you know. Like,
what
maybe
did she say?
She was like, yeah, sure.
Just
like, so I interrupted. I was like, you know, I'm sorry, dude. I got to give her some money here. And like, tried to cut him off. It was just like, it was amazing. I've read emails like that. And I know people like, Bill, I'm sure you've gotten contact like that. But it was another thing to have someone who had never heard of her before.
Oh, yeah.
Look her in the eye and do it in real
time. It's like a live action reenactment of a Tumblr comment.
It was amazing.
Or something like, hey, will you draw my thing for free? Yeah.
Oh.
Man, I had a creeper who came to my table who was trying to show me all the photos of all the cosplayers he's taken.
Yeah.
This old guy who seemed nice enough until... Like, there was one of the sexy cosplayers walked by, and he's like, oh, man, what do you think about that? And I was like, And he was like, oh, yeah, I took a photo of her. And he's like, pulled out his iPhone, and he's like, showing me all these photos he took of her, like, at Rose City. He's like, oh, yeah, she was at San Diego. She was dressed like this weird little mouse thing. And he pulls up this, like, full folder on his iPhone, like, full of folders of her dressed as Pikachu that he had taken at San Diego Comic-Con, I guess?
He's like, even know
oh, yeah.
Who Pikachu was.
Yeah, no, he was obviously there just to take photos of hot ladies. And somehow he must have just, like, I must give out really good lonely pervert vibes. Because this guy really thought, like, I was a kindred soul, where he's like, oh, yeah. And he's like, oh, that's how you get these pictures. You got to become friends with them, and they'll let you take pictures of anything. And, like, he started showing me all these photos of other girls had taken, like, not even necessarily sneaking, but just, like, all these photos of him with all these half-naked sexy ladies in cosplay from these different conventions. And thank God someone came up to interrupt the conversation, and he just kind of shuffled off and wandered away. But it got really weird. It got to the point where I was almost going to be like, it's just so weird that he would, like, a perfect stranger would, like try to confide in me, like, oh, yeah, here's my little menagerie of hot little ladies. And I was like...
I can't wait for all the sexy pictures I can get at the Lego convention next week.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
I'm hoping I'm going to see someone in the big conical head, the big claw hands, blocky torso.
That's the best thing about Lego. It's very hard to sexualize Lego in any capacity. In fact, anything, Lego, the whole point of Lego is kind of desexifying and making everything kind of gross and cartoony and weird.
Foley was making fun of me because I've been writing little short stories about my Benton, which is my Western Lego Animal Town. And I posted one online, and I had her read it. And she just looks at me, and she said, they had sex. And I'm like, well, they're a married couple. I mean, they're gonna have sex. She's like, they're Lego.
You're friends with Sam Elliott. Have you ever gotten in touch with him about doing dramatic readings about your fiction about Benton?
Bill.
This is Benton. I'm sure everyone had claws for hands.
Okay.
Yeah, they got wolf heads.
That's
my endgame. As soon as Rose City was over, of course, I'm still heavily in debt for all the prints I bought to sell at Rose City, so I didn't technically make any money yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I did make, you know, did get some cash from Rose City. First thing I do is go to Lego.com to be like, oh man, I'm gonna buy me a Lego just to congratulate myself on having a great. And I just totally forgot what the point of me bringing that up was. Oh, there was a Lego. Where if you spend over $99 right now, you get a free Chima figure, like an exclusive Chima figure. And that was almost my how I was going to like justify suddenly buying a new thing, because Annie needs that Chima hit.
You're very sweet, Bill. Well, I'll tell y'all, I spent over $50 at Lego, and I got it too. So.
Oh, yeah, you did? Oh, okay.
And it's a head that I have about 10 of. Well, so.
They had Lego stuff at Rose City Comic Con. Did you get anything?
I did. I went to Bricks and Minifigs, actually had a booth.
Yeah, I went there too, yeah.
And did you see the booth behind them? I think they're called Brick Forge. I can't remember now.
Yeah, they had super expensive, like, little custom kits.
Yeah, did you see their Doctor Who?
Yeah, it was $100, and I was kind of tempted for half a second, but then I realized if I went to Bricks and Minifigs, I could probably build one of those sets with, like...
Yeah.
$50 of just like stuff I can get from there. So
the thing is that they don't do custom parts. They just use off the shelf parts.
Oh, but then they put like little customized sets though. Like yeah.
Yes, they put them together. I'm saying you can make them.
So for $100, you could buy like a little Lego TARDIS with like Matt Smith and Amy Pond, like mini little Lego minifigures.
But yeah.
Yeah, from those guys, I just bought like a brick separator keychain.
Yeah.
Yeah, the only booth, they had a DeLorean from Back to the Future there. I didn't even get a chance to see because I was so busy. Yeah. The only booth I managed to check out was, Claire Hummel. I bought, she had a brand new fantastic Iron Giant fan art prints there.
Yeah, that was great.
She had a Legend of Korra thing I bought and a bottle of her art books, and they swung by Bricks and Mimi Figs on the way back, and I got the new Legend of Korra art book from Dark Horse. Those were literally the only three things I bought the whole time there. But yeah, a good time. Roar City was pretty. Oh, and the cool cosplay I saw was there was two girls dressed like Gravity Falls.
Yeah, they were cute as hell.
And the girl dressed, it was great because the one girl dressed like Mabel, she had made her own Waddles doll, the pig, and that was fucking cute as balls. And the girl dressed like Dipper, she had like powdered her, like reddened up her nose, so she looked like. I was like, oh my god, they looked like, the costumes were just spot, it was just,
it's great.
I was like, oh my god. And there was a kid dressed as Gentleman Broncos, of all kinds of things, the Sam Rockwell movie, where he was dressed like post-apocalyptic Sam Rockwell, carting around this deer with rockets taped to its side. Which, it doesn't make any sense unless you've seen that movie, but it was fucking hilarious.
Did you see the lady in the motorized scooter dressed like Tina Turner from Beyond Thunderdome?
Are you serious?
She was my favorite.
You know, each convention, do conventions have like a photo booth where you can go and like, how do conventions not have like,
like just an inventory, a cosplay inventory?
That should be, because that should be like every convention's pride and joy is like, here's our cosplay page from last year. Here's like, because that stuff, like, again, that's worth half, worth half the impressive admission right there. It's just, you know, like crazy shit.
Though I did want to say, so Rose City is a great show, but they have a bad habit of sometimes sticking people, artists with booths in the middle of the resellers and all that sort of stuff. So poor Claire Hummel was stuck, caught between two resellers booths. But the one that broke my heart the most, did you see Chris Baldwin and Kevin Moore's booth?
I did not see it, but I heard about it, and I couldn't believe, I kind of could not believe they were even at the convention, because once I saw what the convention was like, and saw how much 99% of the convention was cosplay and steampunk stuff, on top of the fact they were out in the weeds, out in the middle of nowhere.
They were not only that, Bill, it was poor Chris Baldwin, who I'm pretty sure is a vegetarian, as I recall, next to a beef jerky booth.
Are you serious?
That's serious. It was amazing.
Chris Baldwin, he's a fantastic cartoonist, but he's like, he's a known, especially in the indie, Portland indie comics community, he's an old bellwether. He's knocked out a ton of great comics and stuff.
Yeah.
Not the sexiest, most, like, it's indie comics, though, and he's very low-key about how the way he sells stuff, but he's a great guy to hang out with. So he should have been, like, part next to Periscope or other people who, he should have been part of, like, kind of like our corner of the show floor. Yeah, not next to the beef jerky booth.
It broke my heart. The thing is that Space Trawler, his comic, is perfect for this crowd. Like, I wish that for every person who got a free thing of beef jerky that they had gone over and taken a look at Space Trawler.
Yeah, his comics are fantastic, but like, it's not the flashiest, sexiest stuff that would be easy to sell at a convention like that. Well, that's the other thing. I got kind of freaked out because I was just selling all my copyright infringement stuff, all my video game apps and stuff like that. And that's what so many other people were selling, was all like Doctor Who shit and like...
Yeah.
It got to the point where even I was thinking, man, this is a little gross. This is a little, like... There is original stuff there, but then again, even a lot of the original stuff was kind of like steampunk or kind of like badly drawn things.
It makes sense because you think about that show. Someone who's dressed like Doctor Who and coming to the thing is going to be really excited about a Doctor Who print.
Oh yeah, exactly. But it was a little. One of the best parts of the convention too was I was actually part of a fan art panel.
Yeah.
Talk about all kind of fan art stuff, and that was kind of cool. But yeah, that's like at the panel, I kind of like. I confessed I was like a little overwhelmed at how much other copyright infringement stuff was going on there. So.
Yeah.
But it says the guy who one of the only things he bought was an Iron Giant and a Legend of Korra print. I'm so used to showing up at Snuffed Comics Fest where everyone else really did have their own thing, and I was kind of the one rare guy who showed up with like, here's, you know, video game stuff. Now, what a convention where everyone was selling that stuff. It was a little like, oh my god, this is like how entire conventions.
Yeah.
I found it. It's just by people just drawing fan art and selling it. It just seemed really crazy. But anyway.
Hey, Bill, hold on for just a second. Your audio is starting to sound like you're talking through a tin can phone.
Really?
Yeah.
Hello. I keep on leaning back from my microphone.
No, it's not just that. It's like it's all crunchy and distorted. It's very
clearly digital. This isn't fixing it?
Nope.
Okay, hold on.
It's clearly in the compression somewhere.
Okay.
I don't know if you're I mean, you guys have crazy good internet.
So. Yeah. Still not helping?
Mm-mm.
No! Maybe, hold on, let's see. I'm gonna have to stop my GarageBand recording real quick.
Sure.
I'm gonna unplug my mic and plug it back and see if that does anything. Hold on. So it's at 26 minutes? Okay. Pause. Oh my god.
Much better. Oh, now I can't hear you anymore.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Is it better?
Yeah, so much better. It's not crunchy anymore.
I love you! You know what? I don't know if there's something wrong with this mic, because I've noticed... Oh, it was last week, actually. I wound up having to revert back to our YouTube sound. Because there was something, I think I might have to mind, because like over the course of the last week's episode we recorded, my sound got crunchier and crunchier until I was almost inaudible. Although it seemed to come out relatively okay over YouTube. Anyway, let's get back to talking about stuff.
Okay.
We'll figure out technical stuff later.
Okay. Let's see. So yeah, I had a great time at Rose City Comic Con, though. I think I did the perfect visit to Rose City. Foley had never been to a comic show like that before.
Mm-hmm.
Like, she had never been to a pop culture show or anything like that. And she doesn't always do super well with crowds. So I think we did the perfect sort of visit to that sort of thing where we got in early and so we wandered around before it was super slammed. And then we left for a couple hours and built Lego and just kind of took some quiet restorative time and then came back and wandered around a little more. So
that's a good way to spend it. Because that convention was super goddamn crowded, too. It's not the world's biggest convention, but it was pretty packed.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah.
So it was a good time, and it was lovely to meet. Let's see, not only was Max there, but we also met Cannon Hart, good old friend of the podcast. And I very briefly got to listen, got to meet Monica, who's also a Boy Howdy listener. So, what's going on over there, Bill?
I'm just contemplating. I just went into a very... No, I'm sorry. I'm actually reading the question-and-answer questions we have in the YouTube chat thing. Just Helen Haddon, she's also pointing out that sometimes my audio goes fritzy when I'm talking to her on Skype. And also a whole bunch of questions from Russian people. Something about exhaustively blog, Zuckflock Axenweck. And that's pretty much it. And anyway, this is such a junky podcast.
This is a bad one.
Yeah.
So we went to see Maze Runner. Maze Runner was pretty good. So I'll tell you, I'll just say
don't talk about Maze Runner.
No, I'll be brief. Any other arachnophobes, don't go see Maze Runner.
Oh, that bad, huh?
Well, no, the villainous things were these big kind of robo scorpion spider things that made me feel weird. But what's funny is that so the whole movie is about this mysterious maze that you know nothing about, and then at the end they abruptly shove in a ton of explanation and stuff and world building and stuff, and so I get home and it's very open ended and it's like, how are these teens so special now that they've run the maze and how are they going to save the world? And I went home and read the I went home and read the Wikipedia entry explaining it all, and I was just like, oh, this is really bad.
You chicken friend bullshit.
This is really bad. It's
not. Now, is this another series, YA series that got turned into a movie that started off as fan fiction for something else?
No. These actually were just straight up books, and they predated Hunger Games, so.
Who's the baker guy in Hunger Games? Is it PETA?
Yeah. It's PETA Bread. That's how I remember his name.
I was going to say, does he not make donuts, and so technically he could be considered the Glaze Runner?
Okay, Bill, that joke is so much better. That's so much better than your other joke. Very excited about it. I've been between Matt as soon like literally Max's plane left 2 hours after my parents' plane arrived.
Tell me about this, because Yeah, go ahead.
Well, I was gonna say, so they saw you on their way back from the airport?
Yeah, so I hired a cab to take Maxwell to the airport, and I got so tired of Max's shit by the time she was gone, I ordered the guy to assassinate her, but it didn't go right, because I wound up in the car with her, and I was like, oh my god, I don't want to die too, so I wound up having to sit around and feed her macaroons until she left. And I was like, god damn it.
This sounds very likely, Bill.
She escaped. Because we me and Annie have this unspoken policy that, like, we can't let our listeners leave alive because we have dark secrets that they're exposed to. We can't let the world know what terrible hosts we are.
Max saw too much
So, escape. But that Maxwell actually managed to escape with a belly full of macaroons back to the UK, unfortunately. So I took the red line back into town, took the bus back, stopped by Freddy's, and when I was waiting for the bus back from Freddy's, yeah, your parents just happened to drive, but there's a honking car. Then, like, this Maxwell's probably not even on her plane yet.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was sitting there like, yeah, just on the street corner, and like, it's your parents in Hong Kong driving by, like, Annie's folks, okay, yeah, so.
They felt really bad, actually, afterwards. They're like, we should have given him a ride!
I don't know, I was only, like 15 blocks away from, it was, like, a 10-second bus, and I already had a bus ticket from coming in from the airport anyway, so it was, like, nothing, but it was cool to see them for 10 seconds.
Yeah, so, yeah, my folks are visiting from Texas, and we're having a lovely time just hanging out. We showed them the Lego movie last night that they enjoyed very much.
Aww.
So, but so the thing that I've been waiting, because we've had guests all month, I've been waiting for everybody to be gone.
So okay to say that out loud.
No, because I've been wanting to play Wasteland 2. I backed Wasteland on Kickstarter, and it came out right during Guestageddon. And I love all of our visitors. Don't get me wrong. It's been great. But I've been like, I want to play Wasteland 2. So I finally got to play some of it last night. And it's great. It's totally scratching my Fallout 1 and 2 itch.
Is this the Fallout clone that's made by the guys like originally made Fallout or something? Or is this just inspired by Fallout?
Sort of, except not at all. Fallout was inspired by Wasteland, which was a computer RPG in the 80s. They actually tried to get the Wasteland license to make a game, couldn't, and instead made Fallout. So the team that's working on worked on this were also some people who worked on Fallout 1 and 2. Okay. Most notably Brian Fargo and... So this is a sequel to the game that inspired Fallout.
Okay.
So it's not really a knockoff.
So there's no, like, underground bunkers or anything? Like,
I've only played a couple hours, so who knows?
Had you not played the original Wasteland stuff?
They did give it as a backer, and I played a little bit of it, but it's an old game. Yeah. Dude. It is an 80s RPG. It is not fun. So, I've been playing it a little bit. It's a lot of fun. Just like in Shadowrun. I loved Shadowrun. I had a great time with Shadowrun. Just like with Shadowrun, I had a lot more fun once I realized how to cheat. And I just went in and tweaked all my characters and boosted everything. Because I'm just playing it for, the joy of playing it and the pleasure of the narrative and the world and everything like that. What's nice is that Wasteland is very similar to Fallout, except it has more of a Wild West sort of flavor to it. So it is right up my alley, and I'm having a great time with it. And part of that is that there are a lot of rad lady characters in this game. I've met, like, a lot of really compelling females. It's been a lot of fun, so I'm enjoying Wasteland 2. It's very old school, and it's very cumbersome to play. It's one of those games where you have a party of five people, and you hit a locked door, you have to go in and manually select your lock picker, your lock picking tool, and then go, as opposed to
the new game.
Yeah. I mean, I've been replaying Fallout 2, and Fallout 2, if I try to repair something, my team member who's like the repair guy will go, let me take care of that boss and go and fix it for me. So it's a little more cumbersome in that regard, but I'm enjoying it. It's those sorts of games feel like home to me in a real way, just because Fallout was so important to me. So I'm having a good time with it. And it's great that this came out because Foley is working on a comic. So now she can keep her head down in the office and actually make things, and I can keep my head down and shoot mutated Gecko. So anyway, that's been Annie's monologue while Bill tunes out. Bill, what have you been up to?
What's that?
What have you been up to, Bill?
Playing little bits and pieces of Destiny, just trying to still tolerate that game, but pissing me off. They announced that they're fixing some of the loot stuff with a patch next week, so I'm going to completely just stop playing that game until that patch comes out.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a loot dynamic in Destiny where you get, like, this diagram. Some enemies will drop a diagram that you have to take to another person to decode, and that diagram will turn into, like, a piece of armor or a gun.
Yeah.
And the color of the diagram that drops shows you what kind of quality of the whatever mm-hmm. piece of equipment the thing will turn to once it's been decrypted by this guy.
Mm-hmm.
The way Destiny works right now is oftentimes when you get that diagram decoded and it turns into an actual weapon or something like that, it's actually of a substantially lesser value of whatever color-coded hierarchy that the diagram was when you first picked it up.
Mm-hmm.
It almost seems like a bug, but it's like Bungie's come out and said, no, this is the way it's supposed to work. We thought this was a good idea. The fact that, like, when you pick up something that it may actually turn out to be far lesser value than it originally seems. They're like, no, yeah, we thought it was a good idea. And everyone's like, you're fucking crazy. So they're going to actually patching that. And also just I've already played everything you can do in Destiny like 15,000 fucking times.
Yeah.
But there's new games coming out next week. I forgot we're at the time of the year where new games are coming out like every week. I mean, whether or not you're into those games is a whole different thing.
Have you been reading the reviews of Shadows of Mordor?
Shadow of Mordor. The only history I have with Shadow of Mordor was there a games writer called named Bat... Oh, my low blood sugar just suddenly hitting it. Burst. A games journalist named Kat Bailey, she was at GDC last spring, and she had been hearing from other people about how the game systems in Shadow of Mordor are supposed to be really fucking crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And if she gave a couple examples of, like, yeah, if you shoot a guy in the arrow at the beginning of the game and he survives, he'll come back with, like, an eye patch later. And a kind of weird
thing. Oh, seriously?
Like that. And that's all I heard about. I was like, that sounds kind of cool, but that sounds like something, like, people would claim they can pull off at GDC, but when the game comes out 6 months later, it's not going to have that shit. And but the game, the reviews came out, and everyone's like, it's got that shit in it.
Yeah.
And all I know, I have not actually read any of the reviews. I just saw some of the scores, and everyone's like, this game's fucking, it's like a game of the year contender now.
I haven't been reading the reviews because it sounds like the kind of game that, kind of like Saints Row, where I'm going to enjoy it more if I just go into it knowing that people are enjoying it and comparing it to other games that I like and I should just discover it.
But yeah, so that's why I haven't been reading anything, because I want to go in blind because I've gotten this far and the game comes out like in 2 days. Yeah.
The screenshot that keeps floating around that's killing me is a screenshot of, he's like, you press L2 to enter stealth mode. Press X to kiss your wife in stealth mode.
That screen cap even before you posted or whatever, and I was like, that is totally Andy's gonna, if Andy sees that, that's gonna become an Andy thing, and it did. Yeah, you clung on to that. I was like, oh, Andy's gonna buy this game. Well, the thing is, are you gonna buy it this week? Because
what system are you buying it for?
PlayStation 4. Everything I can. If I can buy it for PlayStation 4, it's PlayStation 4.
Okay, I may actually... if I can,
yeah, if you want to wait a week or two, because there's more games coming out. Like, Alien comes out next week, like next Tuesday, so hopefully I'll try to finish Mordor by next week, and I'll move on to Alien.
Yeah, just because, like I said, I'm so fucking bro.
So, yeah, hopefully, well, maybe, I don't know how long Mordor is, but if it's only, like, an 8-hour campaign, maybe if I can beat it by next Sunday, if we record in person, or we can do it with some kind of handoff or something like that, I can give it to you. We'll see, we'll see. Like, yeah, I'll get it, and... And well, there's also Forza 2 coming out on Tuesday, which I really like. That's a sequel to an Xbox kind of off-road racing game, which is really fun. Yeah. Then there's also, like, the PlayStation 4 exclusive racing game is coming out, like, a week after that.
Yeah, like, Drive Club. Race against my Drivatar, is that
I know, yeah. Well, I didn't realize the Drive Club, it's actually made by the same people who made the MotorStorm games for the PlayStation 3.
Really?
Which, those are really fun, really pretty-looking games, and, like, the footage I've seen from Drive Club looks really goddamn gorgeous. There's all kinds of really cool, like, weather effects and stuff. Mm-hmm. Who knows how it plays, but, like, it looks gorgeous. But, I can't remember what else is coming out soon within the next couple weeks, but just those games are right there. That's enough to... Yeah, I think my time with Destiny is kind of at a kaput for a while.
And I'm just holding my breath for fucking Dragon Age Inquisition.
But yeah, that's a month and a half away. That's like 2 months away, though. That's the unfortunate thing, yeah. Boo, 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 boo.
And man, Assassin's Creed Unity comes out like the same week. If only, like, Assassin's Creed could come out a month before Dragon Age.
Oh, Sleeping Dogs comes out in like in a week and a half.
Sleepy Dogs! Man,
are you thinking about picking?
Well,
you're broke, so you're not going to pick up the remake of a game you've already beaten.
I love Sleeping Dogs, and I would support it in a heartbeat, except I can't. Oh my god, I can't. I mean, I'm actually, like, I'm worried about how we're going. It's so helpful.
you're only getting married in a year. You only need vast amounts of money to pull that off, too.
Man, I put in my first... I wrote my big, big multi-digit check for a deposit for our venue.
No, yeah.
I got a quote back from one vendor. We wanted to do for wedding presents. We wanted to do bandanas. We're gonna have our friend Kate design them, and I was talking to a local printer about quotes, just general quotes. I was like, if we want to do this sort of printing on this sort of bandana, one color, 200 units, how much? He came back, he said $913, and I'm actually considering it. I put it in my budget and everything. So you are talking to a person who is seriously considering spending $1,000 on custom bandanas.
Does your wedding gift need to be like a couple $100 check for like the bandana gifts?
Well, it's $5 per bandana, so if everybody can just pay me $5 for their wedding gift, I'm fine. It's gonna be good.
That actually would be the craziest idea.
Well, I wanted to do a lot of them because I'm not inviting 200 people, but I wanted to have extras, and I actually wanted to give some out to any Boy Howdy listener who wanted one. Yeah, it's fucking money, man. I did my budget. I started a Google Doc that we break down everything we have quoted so far, and then you assign what category it is, and it dynamically updates this pie chart, so we can kind of get a sense of where our money is going and everything like that. And I shared it with Foley, and while we were both at work, and I went in on my lunch break. Foley was also on her lunch, and she was in the middle of adding a field for sex with Tom Hardy category entertainment, $10,000. I'm like, I married the right lady. I'll tell you that.
Yeah, I should invest. Like, do they still? There was a famous. There was two ladies back in the 60s and 70s who were famous. They would take plaster molds of rock stars' penises. You should see if they could do the same thing with, like, Tom Hardy and, like, other, like...
I don't just want his genitalia.
I'm sure he has nice genitalia, too. I'm not saying that's the whole point of Tom Hardy, but hey.
Bill, if you've seen Bronson, we are aware of these things.
If someone gave you a hat rack that was just Tom Hardy's penis just bolted to a wall, would you accept it?
No.
Okay.
No, I would not.
I'm looking at it in my Amazon wish list and games coming out. There's actually not that many. But yeah, Alien comes out next week. Dragon Age comes out November 18th, which is 2 months away.
Yeah.
There's a Halo Master Chief Collection, which I'm only interested in. That comes out at the beginning of November. Sunset Overdrive. Witcher doesn't come out till February. Yeah, Assassin's Creed Unity comes out the week before Assassin's Creed. That's November 11th.
Yeah.
And I think that's more... Far Cry. November 18th is Dragon Age, Far Cry 4... and the Grand Theft Auto remake all coming out the same day.
Maybe I should cancel my... Because I pre-ordered both Assassin's Creed games, because they both seem relevant to my interests.
Really? Well, I mean, yeah. You can definitely...
I love Assassin's Creed!
No, I'm just kidding, but you can definitely... You can just get one, and the other one will be dirt cheap, and, like, by Christmas. Black Friday sales?
Really, what I should do is cancel both of them, because I'm really going to play Dragon Age, and that's all I'm going to care about, and then I should pick up them both later when I'm done with Dragon Age.
Yeah, if you can survive that 1 week between when they come out and then Dragon Age coming out, then you could... If you wait, like, 3 weeks, you'll be able to buy both games for half off.
Yeah, that's actually a good idea. I need to do that.
What do you mean? You don't have to do it now. You got 2 months to make that decision, is all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
Anyway, so video games. Yeah, so most importantly, the thing that's coming up in the very near future that we're both excited about is, of course, Season 4 of Legend of Korra comes out, next week? October 3rd? October 4th?
It's this Friday.
And so the trailer...
The final season of Legend of Korra, yeah.
The trailer just came out. It looks so good. That shit's a good shit.
It takes place 3 years after the last season, too. Which I'm glad, because Korra got all fucked up, and this actually will explain it. I'm just saying.
Short-haired Korra. Asami with her mom hair.
Did you see the bad guy seems to be like that little bit of a like metal bending guard you saw for 10 seconds at the end of the last season, so everyone's already doing like, oh yeah, they're gonna make out because they have the same haircut. Now they look,
it is how that works. It's terrible. I'll be walking down the street, I see another one with Bob, I'm just like...
Did you see the spoiler, like, so like, it wasn't a part of the official trailer I saw, but everyone else flipping out about, like, there's another character development that's going to happen. And I was like, where the fuck is this coming from? Because everyone's assuming this is, like, a thing. And then I did see a clip that actually shows that something's happening to a character that I was like, oh, shit, they're actually going to do that. Did you know what I'm talking about?
I don't know.
Okay, it's spoiler stuff. Where I was like,
I do the trailer ended with Korra looking off screen and going, "Toph," which is enough to make me so excited.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about. Maybe I saw a different trailer because I didn't see that.
It's at the end of the trailer, yeah.
Oh, is that what
it's like? It's when it seems to be over, and then they cut back to.
Oh, I must have stopped it because I was like, "Oh, that's the end."
No, nope.
That's what I was talking about. Toph's coming back.
Toph's coming back. So good.
Man,
so
excited. It's good. Again, this season could be terrible, but it'll be worth it just for Buttface McCanny's drawings of these characters. Like, yeah, no.
Yeah. If y'all are a Korra fan or even an Avatar fan and are not familiar with the art of McCanny, I highly recommend looking her up. I think her Tumblr is mckaniart.tumblr.com.
Yeah, M-A-K-A-N-I. All you really have to do is Google that term and you'll find her Tumblr, and like these days all of her posts are just about Avatar The Last Airbender.
It's so good. She's been doing a lot of really great Lin Beifong art. It's so good. It is a crime that Dark Horse hasn't given her a pile of money to do some.
Yeah, she actually comics. Just last night she posted a whole bunch of stuff about Pema and Tenzin.
Yeah.
And like how they were breaking up around the time, it's good stuff. And it's great because she draws like little comics. Not only is her fan art, but she's like rounding out character stuff we haven't seen about the older beat up characters, which is kind of great to see. Yeah. Man, and I'm still pissed off. Like, Dark Horse never did anything with all of her Mass Effect. Like, her volumes. She could have filled like two books full of all of her Mass Effect sketches in Mass Effect 3.
The thing with Mass Effect is that it's very clear when you look at all the Mass Effect comics. All of them have been driven by people involved with Mass Effect. Like, they're actual writers for Mass Effect, who, between you and me, are not necessarily... When you write video games, that doesn't mean you know how to write comics.
Yeah, you're not a fucking novelist or anything, yeah.
And, anyway, well, no, just comics, the language of comics is very different from the language of other medium. And, but whereas with the Dark Horse, with Avatar, they very clearly have a little more of a free reign because all of, what's his name, Gene Yang's comics for... Yeah. Avatar have been phenomenal, and the art has been phenomenal. So, I'm just saying, Korra has made $0, but maybe we'll do a Kickstarter, Dark Horse. Call me, I'll do the video.
That's a terrible thing, because there's absolutely no justification to have Korra comics, because, like, three people watch that show, and those are three people, two of them are going to buy the comic.
Yep, and they're both us, so...
I know, exactly.
This demographic, y'all got it down. If you
speaking of stupid Avatar stuff, there's an online reviewer guy called the Nostalgia Critic, who just reviews, like, pop culture stuff from the 90s, and also he's reviewed some more, like, recent stuff, and he just relatively recently got into Avatar The Last Airbender stuff. Mm-hmm. And he just had a countdown list this week of the top 11 best Avatar episodes. Mm-hmm. And in order to help present these top 11 Avatar episodes on this countdown for his YouTube video series, he had Dante Bosco show up dressed as Zuko. And Dante Bosco loses his mind and thinks he actually is Zuko and starts chasing this guy around with, like, firebending. And he chases him to a Barnes & Nobles, and they're blowing up the Barnes & Nobles. And, like, this Nostalgia Critic guy defends himself with a copy, like, a hardback copy of, like, the Avatar comics. And, like, Dante Bosco's like, what a well-written comic. Everyone should buy this. And it was just, like, very stupid, like, shilling for the Dark Horse Korra Avatar stuff. But it was kind of cute.
We've talked about this before, but real quickly before we move on, those Avatar comics are good. If you like those original Avatar series, gotta read those Avatar comics.
Yeah, so after the Nostalgia Critic defends himself with like one of the Avatar comics, Dante Bosco, the guy who plays Zuko, also Rufio, they make a couple of funny Rufio jokes in this video too. He grabs the comic, cracks it open, and he's like, "Oh, that's what happened to my mom." it's cute. It's cute. Anyway. What else?
Bill, I'm all done. Tell me about Star Wars Rebels.
Star Wars Rebels is essentially the sequel series to the Clone Wars CGI cartoon that got canceled. This is the new CGI series from the same people. This is the one that takes place just like a couple years right before the first Star Wars movie. And so it's like, you know, you got Darth Vader and Stormtroopers and shit running around. And this series is... about how these, like, it's about this small group of rebels who end up picking up this little kid who is essentially just a ripoff of Aladdin, and how he ends up joining the Rebel Alliance, and it's all about, like, the rebel movement, like, kind of leading up to the events of the very first Star Wars movie. Yeah. And they put out the first two episodes as a little TV movie. It's not very good.
Yeah.
But then again, also, like, the kind of TV movie that they put out in theaters, like, for the first chunk of, like, that essentially formed the first, like, three episodes of the original Clone Wars series, that was also terrible.
Yeah.
And not that this show was terrible, but it's, like, it's one of those things where it's kind of clumsily written pilot where all the characters are running around. It's this crew of rebel guys. And essentially Firefly, they have this grungy little ship that's like the Millennium Falcon. They're just running around getting in adventures. And this Aladdin kid meets this ship full of people. And the ship full of people, they're pretty much their only roles in the whole show is just to kind of keep on reiterating what their character, like, archetype is. Like, there's a big, gruff monster guy who's like, "Arr, I'm a big monster. I hate little kids." And, like, there's a sassy pilot lady, and she's like, "I'm the sassy pilot lady. I'm the maternal influence on this group."
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like there's no real story. It's just, like, characters. And there's the sassy... When we had our last Star Wars podcast with Conley, Mike Russell, and Bobby Roberts, Conley was flipping out about how one of the characters on the show is essentially a Boba Fett person, like a Mandalorian person with, like, the mask, like, the big bucket, like, helmet with the visor and everything like that, except she's pink because she's a girl. And so she's just like, "It's a fucking pink Mandalorian," and she's really into art. Although, at least in the pilot of the show, she's really into art and also explosives.
Yeah.
Low stuff, but she's still like, "I'm going to spray paint graffiti on this because I'm a pink punk man Boba Fett lady." And, not a lot of character growth. It's a lot of just like, kind of flow. But I don't know. The show definitely has room to improve. But yeah.
Is also oriented towards 12-year-old boys, so...
Yeah, but then again, I just... Whatever. Here's like a 40-year-old man complaining about a children's cartoon.
"This cartoon is not as complex as I would have written it if I was joining it. It's hard to do this TV show."
All right, Bill, do you have any other notes, or can we go on to the Geek Week in Review?
Oh, no, are we out of juice? Is this it? Oh, no, but I guess I did talk about the Anglophenia. Circling back real quick to Siobhan Thompson and the Anglophenia YouTube series. Yeah, this is the other major thing I did was, when Maxwell was here, like I said, she introduced me to this Anglophenia YouTube series that talks about British culture. There, one of the videos that Siobhan Thompson has on the Anglophenia video series is Top 10 British TV Shows That Everyone Talks About in Britain. Mm-hmm. One of the shows is called The Great British Bake Off, which is a cooking competition held in a tent in this, like, English garden, which is, it's a cooking competition, but it's super low-key, and everyone's kind of really friendly with it. It's the most British thing possible, because they're all just making pies and stuff, but everyone's very nice to each other, and it's very cordial, and even though it's still that kind of cooking competition thing where everyone gets, there's someone gets picked to get booted off every episode, it's very much like, "Oh, I knew I was going to get booted off, so I will go now. It's okay." So I've been watching a whole bunch of that, and it's very cute. And then there's also, because of this video series and because of Maxwell Motley, I was exposed to a show called Time Team, which this sounds nuts, but it's an archaeological show where archaeological teams are given 3 days to excavate as much stuff as they can from a random archaeological site.
Yeah.
And the show is just about showing what they can dig up in 3 days, and so it's all about them running all over Britain, like, digging up, like, ancient Roman roadways, or, like, all kinds of, Viking shit over here, and, like, this stuff over there. This show that's been on the air for 20 years, it just got canceled.
Huh.
I just found it out about now, so I found a couple episodes online, and I was like, this is a cool show, and it's a show that's pimping archaeology.
You have a lot of catching up to do, my friend.
Yeah, but Mr. Push. Oh, one of the things they were talking about, there was an old special they had like 10 years ago where they were allowed to go into the Windsor Castle in the UK, and they actually found the Henry V. He decided to build his own round table based off of the Arthurian legends.
Oh, really?
And so they the building is long gone, but they managed to figure out at Windsor Castle he had built his replica round table. Huh. He was so into the Arthurian legends. And just weird shit like that. Like, if you're into British history at all, it's just really crazy. Like I said, it's the thing where they have to dig up everything he can in 3 days.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's pretty cool. So Time Team and the Great British Bake Off. Those two shows, you can find them online if you poke around. They're very goddamn fun.
Oh, Max. Max, you may be gone, but your presence, you're still present with us.
Insta lies forever.
Ooh. All right, friends, we're going to take a little break, and then we'll be back for the Geek Week in Review.
Oh, yeah.
All right, bear with me a second, Bill. I got to go get some water, and I'll be right back. And
by water, you mean you got poop. How's everyone doing at home? The one viewer we got.
Everyone else is left. Helen Haddon's taking a poop. Annie's taking a pee. Everyone's sleepy.
It's 11 o'clock on a Sunday morning. No one should be required to be conscious or all that shit together. I obviously don't have my shit together. I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about right now. But yeah, Savon Thompson, whatever her name is. She's funny. I like her. She does all kinds of crazy accents. Did I do anything else this week, Erlyn? Yeah, Destiny. Destiny's driving me nuts. I'm playing with Grumpy Turtle. And ugh. It's fun. It's fun. That is the best thing about Destiny, is being able to play with other people. That is the only reason why I've stuck around that game as long as I have. Just because, yeah, the social aspect is really fun. And playing with Jimmy and Conley every once in a while, too, has been kind of fun. But, yeah, just... ugh, having to replay all those missions over and over again, it's just a little rough. Hey, Annie wasn't kidding. She's back.
Alright.
What'd you do? Bill. What happened?
Oh, I just appreciate you giving me a chance of hydration.
Mama, mama.
It's the most interesting part of the podcast for our viewers.
Yeah.
Alright.
Making something, too.
Would you like to go get... we're on a break. Do you want to go get something?
I don't know. I'm fine. I'm just checking the QA just to make sure no one's trying to talk about how they're masturbating to us anymore. I guess we must have driven the guy away.
It happens.
Yeah, that sucks, because I was getting off on someone getting off to me.
I know, it's...
I love the idea of strangers wanting to suck my titties on the internet. You know Futurama?
Yes, I do know Futurama.
You know Kif, the little lizard's companion to What's-His-Face?
Yeah.
I just love your side. When I say shit like that, you're just like...
that's how I feel. Yeah.
Bill! You're Zap Brannigan. What?
Friend of the podcast, Brian Smith, just said, after 2 weeks of effort, I finally bested the last of Mudrun's Geometry Wars 2 high scores.
Wait, what?
Brian Smith, one of our sweet, sweet listeners, just beat your Geometry 2 high scores.
Motherfucker. Is this in the Q&A? I don't even see it.
Oh, no, it's on Twitter.
It's on Twitter. Did I even have that high of a score? Not to be all like, I didn't even know I had a high score.
His goal was just to beat you, my friend.
Brian Smith, you're a beautiful man.
Brian's our friend who will make breakfast and listen to the podcast for...
Yeah, Brian Smith and his lady friend, yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Here's hoping they don't do it while listening to us. Give her an old flourish for us.
Can't finish. Let's hear us go, yeah!
Yeah! Maybe that's their private little in joke. Whenever they finish, that's how they do it. Yeah!
God, I hope. Yeah! You know what? I'm gonna say it. I know. I'm gonna say they have a good enough time that they don't need that going on to add to it.
I think if anything, would be boner killers.
Yeah. All right, friend. You ready to go?
Yes. Okay.
Hey, pals. Welcome back. It's time for the Geek Week in Review.
If you're into that kind of thing, these days, I kind of feel like I'm kind of better than the Geek Week interview. I'm kind of over the Geek Week interview.
I can understand that.
But I just kind of like, yeah, I just pretend to be into it, whatever.
Just to remind y'all, this is, of course, the part of our podcast where I read Bill's notes on pop culture news sight unseen. This is my first time reading these news, so let's go through this journey together.
Woo!
Cones of Dunshire. Gonna be a real game.
I read the details about this, but since we skipped last week, I forget what the details are, but, like, somebody has agreed to turn Cones of Dunshire, the game from Parks and Recreation, into a real goddamn board game.
Yeah. I know that they had turned it into a real game just for a festival, like, some
just
sort
to laugh,
games.
Yeah, somebody had cooked up some, like, tried to make sense of, like, the fucked up rules that...
Yeah.
Well, which character is that? Was it Ben Wyatt?
It's Ben Wyatt. It's Ben Wyatt's game.
Yeah, this is the game that Ben Wyatt devises. Is that when he loses his job and he goes crazy?
Yes, he creates that game, and then later he uses it to get, isn't it free Wi-Fi for Pawnee or something like that?
Or something like that, yeah.
It's good times.
It's all about the cones. It's kind of a medieval, like some kind of like board game that's kind of like a little bit like Catan. I think it's the people who make the Settlers of Catan who are making the Cones of Dunshire.
Oh, that's too good.
The only thing, they need to actually have cones. If it's gonna kill me if they come out with a game and the cones are just like little drawings on cards. They need like the 3-foot cones.
Yeah.
Or at least give you instructions how to make, you know, like, you know, canonically appropriate cones for your game. Oh my god. But yeah.
In other news, Final Fantasy 15, and then Bill has a link as a picture of one of the many photo manipulations that came out. Final Fantasy 15, the trailer came out, is about four dudes going on a road trip in a car. Yeah. And lots of people Photoshop various things of what the four dudes are looking out of their car on, one of which is them going through a McDonald's drive-thru. Yeah.
Literally in our notes. Which is perfect, because they're all just kind of looking off to the side. It looks like, yeah, they're just going to get some Big Macs before going off on a battle.
It's pretty good, man.
Final Fantasy 15, you know what? I know people were bitching about it, especially with the revelation that came out a little bit later that there's not going to be any playable female characters.
Yeah.
I don't give a shit. I just, as long as they do something new with the series.
Yeah.
Like, Final Fantasy got so stale and Final Fantasy 13 was so bad.
Yeah.
That, like, if there's no playable human beings in the game, I'll be happy. I don't really care. It is being passed off to a different director. This is not the guy who's directed, like, last. Well, no, actually, I was going to say, the guy who directed Final Fantasy 13, he's directed like a lot of the other Square games, and he's had a hand in a lot of the like the peripheral Final Fantasy games, but like Final Fantasy 12 was directed by that one guy who went crazy mm-hmm. and left the game like when it was like 2/3 through the development. I think Final Fantasy, I can't remember who directed like Final Fantasy 10. But anyway, this Nomura guy who's kind of like driven Final Fantasy into the ground, he is no longer responsible for Final Fantasy 15, so that's what
I'm gonna do. I just love that it seems to be some sort of post-apocalyptic land with highways, and then, like, monsters and medieval creatures, and these four dudes driving around in a car. It's just, like, somehow, I don't know why a series with gun blades and airships, why a car delights me so much with its unexpectedness.
Well, it's so mundane, and it's four guys in a car. It makes me
so happy. My favorite photo manips have been all the inevitable Zoolander manipulation, like the gif of the four dudes in the car, like the head bobbing.
Yeah, all that stuff, yeah.
That's my favorite.
Well, the weird thing is, I mean, it's only a trailer, so it's not representative of final gameplay, but you see, like, the dudes jump out of the car and they just start beating up monsters. There's no, like, quick time events or anything, or there's no... The trailer presents it as... It's not like, you know, like turn-based stuff. Who knows what the final game is going to be, but it would be kind of cool if you could just jump out of the car and start beating stuff up like, you know, God of War style. I mean, that would be an interesting change. Well, maybe you might, like, your weapon stuff may still have, like, role-playing stats or something like that, but mm-hmm. it'd be interesting they actually kind of mixed up the actual combat stuff, too. Yeah. Who the fuck knows? This game's probably not coming out for another 3 years, and it'll be completely different than what we saw right now, but I don't know, so.
I'm intrigued about this weird
thing. Yeah, the fact that we're even talking about Final Fantasy 15 means they're doing at least something right.
I keep forgetting, like, it's so funny, because Final Fantasy is, to my generation of gamers, was just part of your coming into gaming. Like, if you were really getting into games, you had to play a Final Fantasy or two.
Yeah.
And it's so weird to me that Fully has no context for Final Fantasy whatsoever.
Does she know anything about, like, have she been exposed to, like, does she even know what some of the Final Fantasy games are supposed to be like? Or
The only game she has seen, and she's seen me play at length, is the one with Lightning. What was that, 13?
13, yeah.
She watched that one, and she watched me play a little bit of the MMO when it was on beta for PS4.
Yeah, 14,
that's the extent of her context for Final Fantasy, which is just funny to me. It's just like part of the price of doing business. It'd be like not knowing what Link is.
You know? Exactly, yeah. Well, especially it's crazy to me because I grew up playing the original Final Fantasies on the 8-bit and Super Nintendo.
Mm-hmm.
And so I kind of missed out on like Final Fantasy 7 and like, I played some of 8 and stuff, but like even like, you know, 9 and 10, I actually beat 10. I don't know, but yeah, I kind of started off with the original Final Fantasy, so it's funny to think that here we are talking like 15 games later.
I know.
A bunch of guys in a car beating monsters in the highway.
I really hope that the brand name of the car is Chocobo, though. That would be...
Yeah, that's what everyone's joking about. When you get in the car, it should make like, you know, like the Chocobo theme song. Like,
like that should be the honk. Yeah.
But, you know, actually, when they hit the horn on the car,
that's
Cucaracha. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, man. Anyway.
So another nerd. So that's
right. Yeah, more
in other news, Bad Robot's Millennium Falcon and Batmobile video.
Oh, my God.
No, tell me about it, Bill.
So, 2 weeks ago, the Bad Robot YouTube account posted a video of a Steadicam. It's just a quick shot of, like, the Steadicam slowly flying past the Millennium Falcon, the full-sized real Millennium Falcon they've built for Episode 7 in England. Kind of just, like, skirting past, like, the side of the ship and, like, all lovingly detailed, just showing off the old work they put in this full-scale Millennium Falcon. And then it kind of goes underneath the ship and into, like, this little well beneath the ship. You see that they've just, like, stuck, like, a little Batmobile model from, like, the Chris Nolan Batmobiles, like, is just stuck on the side of the ship. It was just kind of a silly, silly, like, little nod to Batman in the middle of the Star Wars.
Is it painted to look like it's part of the Millennium Falcon?
Yeah, exactly. So it's kind of like Mystery Science Theater style, where they have all the junk on the wall, but it's painted part of the wall, so unless you're really kind of noticing, like, why is that a tennis racket glued to the wall? It's that kind of thing, yeah.
That's pretty funny.
And, yeah, they don't say any characters or anything like that, but this is, like, you know, everyone's like, oh, my God. Aside from that, it's all Millennium Falcon. Like, oh, my God, it's Millennium Falcon and close-up. Yeah. And it looks really good, because, you know, it's like a brand new Millennium Falcon they built, but it looks like the old ship. But, yeah, it was just a stupid thing that happened. So.
Yeah.
But what else? Wait, I need to renew this note. So the radar dish. Oh, this is the thing. So there are spy photos that came from this episode 7 set. They're actually filming outside. They actually have this Millennium Falcon thing just parked outside. They've only built half the ship because they only built the half of the ship with, like, the cockpit and the, like, little ramp that you run up to, because they'll probably just do the rest in CGI. They only need that half of the ship for practical filming purposes. But they do have the radar dish on the other side of the ship, like, built, too, because I guess so they don't have to CGI scan it. Now, instead of the big round radar dish in the original Star Wars movie, it has a square radar dish. Breaking the hearts of Star Wars fans everywhere. That they changed the radar dish on the Millennium Falcon. I actually did see pictures of people posting, because, like, from these spy photos, they circled, like, in the very distance, you can see the Millennium Falcon parked, and you can see it's a different radar dish, and people are going, what the fuck?
Isn't the whole point of the Millennium Falcon that it's a hunk junk and they're always changing out parts anyway?
Well, exactly. The Millennium Falcon, the round radar dish gets knocked off at the end of Return of the Jedi.
Does it?
Death Star. Yeah, so that there's no, even in universe, there's no reason to say it's different, which is the fact that, it's different. People are joking about how upset they are, but even I was on Twitter going, this is the worst thing since 9/11 is the fact the Millennium Falcon has a square radar dish now. So, yeah. It was cute anyway, so. Yeah,
that's pretty stupid. Funny.
Being a nerd.
Yep. Test footage from the Genndy Tartakovsky CGI Popeye was posted to YouTube this week. It's pretty cute.
It looks great.
It's
people pointed out, though, that Popeye no longer has a pipe, which is not surprising.
No.
He doesn't have tattoos on his arms, though.
I didn't notice that.
I haven't gone back to rewatching since then, but that's what people were pointing out. I'm like, that's the whole point of that's the Popeye tattoo, is the anchor.
Huh. Well, I wonder if
it's test footage. Who knows what the final version is going to look like.
I wonder if he gets his tattoo. What if it's a prequel? What if it's an origin story?
Maybe, yeah. Like, his anchor is, like, he gets married to Olive Oil and she's his anchor. There's a whole thing.
There we go.
Like, the movie ends, like, it camera pulls out of the tattoo shop as he's getting his tattoo. And Genndy Tartakovsky, he's the guy who created The Muppet Babies and Gertie the Dinosaur in 1914. they brought him back to make Popeye. John Hammond.
Like that joke.
I'm assuming people listening to us knew who Genndy Tartakovsky is, but yeah.
He's Dexter's Laboratory, Samurai Jack. He did the original Clone Wars shorts. He was involved on Powerpuff Girls, but he is not the creator of Powerpuff Girls.
He got thrown off when he kept on drawing weird, like, his own fan art for the Powerpuff Girls with the girls. Not doing anything too bad, but still a little suggestive enough. They're like, Genndy Tartakovsky, we gotta get the fuck. We need to put you on Star Wars, get you away from these.
Most recently, he did the CGI movie Hotel Transylvania, which we did watch and had some cute elements, but mostly it was just...
That I know a couple people saw that. They were like, it's cute, but it's not. Yeah.
It's really not very memorable. It's actually kind of sad.
Yeah.
But I'm really excited about his Popeye film because he is of Russian descent. He was actually born in Moscow. And he said he learned how to speak English. Like, it was some of his first cartoons ever was watching Popeye.
That's why he's not allowed to talk on any interviews or anything like that.
That's why
he's
said,
heavily accented Russian Popeye.
Exactly. it looks really cute. And so watching that, I had this revelation where I was like, oh my god, Brutus is my kind of guy. And I googled, I was going to tweet this, and I was googling Brutus.
It's okay, Olive Oil's my kind of girl.
Is his name Bluto? I'm saying it wrong.
You know what, depends, because I think sometimes he's Brutus, sometimes he's Bluto. Depending on the cartoon.
I googled him on Google Image Search because I was going to be like, I was going to make a joke about it. And instead, I just found this terrible, computer drawing of Popeye wrestling with Bluto with their limbs were all distended. And it was the weird,
was
I was like.
The funny you posted to Twitter where it was like, yes. Was Popeye slamming his, like, balls against the
pole? Yeah.
Yeah,
it was the weirdest thing. My God. Internet. Bless you.
I love the internet. Yeah.
Anyway, yeah, I'll go see it. I'll go see his Popeye movie. It looks great.
Kind of kills me is, like, I think on the Cartoon Brew, everyone was like, well, okay, well, this cartoon looks good. Who are they going to get to do the voices? And, of course, everyone's like, you know, if in a just world, Robin Williams would have been brought back to do the voice of Popeye. Oh, that's the other thing is the villain of Legend of Korra next season. That's Zelda Williams, Robin Williams' daughter.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. That's pretty cool. And she actually came, she got chased off of Twitter as a result of fallout from the Robin Williams suicide stuff. But she came back, and she came back specifically to pimp Legend of Korra stuff. So I'm glad to see she's back on Twitter, and she's no longer being treated, like, by, you know, evilly by monsters online. So, but yeah, Popeye. Woo!
Popeye! Excited about Popeye.
You can also bring back Shelley Duvall to play Olive Oil. That'd be
great. Have you heard...
Have her to play Olive Oil.
Have you heard, Notes Bill, Apple Wave?
Okay, have you heard about Apple Wave?
Is this the thing that was floating around that said a new part of iOS 8 is you can charge it by putting your phone in the microwave?
My thoughts of people started that. There was supposed to be some kind of new conductive recharging technology that, like, lets you recharge your phone by, just microwaves, so. And the Facebook photo is resulting of this, which is, like, I love people.
Oh, my God.
So you have people taking photos of their phones just boiling up and exploding and just, it was like... I love the internet sometimes. That's a perfect use of the internet.
It's really mean and really cruel, but it's also like... They're like, it only works on iPhone 6s.
Yeah,
iPhone 6 with iOS 8.
Some of these people, the first thing they were doing was taking their iPhones out of the box and just sticking it in the microwave. It's just like, I mean, to be fair, if you don't know that much about technology, I mean, maybe that makes sense. I mean, we're living in a world where you get porn from invisible waves in the air, like magic. Why not charge your phone in the microwave? Oh, God. Anyway, but yeah.
Yeah.
Whoever came up with that, they deserve a fucked up medal.
Kickstarter changed their terms of agreement this week to state the Kickstarter projects must complete their project if funded and fulfill all responsibilities to backers.
Yeah, I forgot to check up on this to see exactly how it means if, like, you have failed, if you like fail to live up to your Kickstarter stuff, if, like, they don't let you fund another Kickstarter or, like, submit another Kickstarter campaign. I don't know what, like, how.
Yeah,
I don't know what, from a practical point of view, this means, but they, at least in their terms of agreement, they are saying, like, you need to do this with the intention of. It's funny that they actually have to clarify the terms of agreement to say you have to intend to actually do right by your customers. But,
because I can't. You know, it wasn't until I was reading about this a little bit that it occurred to me that, like, I'm surprised there hasn't been a publicly, like, known con to use Kickstarter. Like, as I was thinking about it, that's got to be, like, a con artist's wet dream.
It's been a good 3 years now, and you haven't heard anyone... I mean, there's been Kickstarter campaigns that either didn't get funded or got way overfunded that didn't deliver. What, just recently they announced that, what, Neil Stephenson's Clang game. Not that he was specifically trying to fleece people, but they made a couple $1 million, but it turns out, like... Yeah, like they just wound up officially canceling that because
their eyes were bigger than their stomach.
Yeah, and so stuff like that. But yeah, at least so far there hasn't been a thing where somebody obviously very specifically is trying to fleece people. I think there's enough smart people on the internet that, like, when they smell something rotten with a Kickstarter campaign, it gets out and people know not to fund that, and so the Kickstarter slowly dies. So I think it's kind of the internet policing itself there a little bit. But
speaking of fleecing, I meant to talk about this in the first end of the podcast. So pardon me for stopping everything.
You guys went to a sheep farm.
I took my parents I was trying to figure out what to do with my folks, and one of the things I did was I took them on a Portland walking tour that was the Shanghai Tunnel Tour. I'd heard about this, but I'd never known about it. And Portland does have a series of tunnels through our downtown. They were not used to, in fact, kidnap drunks and send them to sea, but they were used because our downtown was higher than our water levels and our docks. So rather than winching, like, products and hauling them up, they just literally knocked out between all the basements and just made this series of tunnels. So you could have, like, raw lumber offloaded from a ship go straight through this series of basements to a basement that had a mill, have them process it into lumber, and then take that lumber back off and load it off to the ship without ever seeing the light of day, really. And but anyway, the other parts of this they talked about was the act of crimping, which was the very legal act of taking men and basically getting them so in debt to you they have no choice but to go to sea for X number of years.
Is it the same thing as press ganging people? Because I know that's when you pretty much browbeat people into going to sea, but I don't know if it was through
it's a different
financial obligation or just like dragging them and dragging them off.
Crimping is specifically an act of blackmail. Yeah. So, like, what often happened was they, you know, this guy who owns a boarding house would see a young man new to Portland sleeping on the streets and say, you know what, kid, I know you're new here and you're just getting on your feet. Why don't you come and stay at my boarding house? It's $2 a day, meals are included. I'll let you stay for a month and why you can get a job, and at the end of the month, just pay me back.
Yeah.
And they would be like, oh, great, and go stay at this boarding house. Along the way, of course, the guy also owned the bar and brothel attached to the boarding house. He'd be like, you know what, kid, go ahead, have a drink on me. Here's a girl, spend some time. So at the end of the month, the guys would have spent the whole month drunk, and, you know, and the boarding house dude would come and say, all right, dude, you owe me, let's say, $120 for food, board, and all the entertainment.
Yeah.
And they have no opportunity to get a job or anything like that because they're too busy carousing. And so he'd say, well, fine, just go to sea. Your options are go to debtor's prison, or here's a job for you. You can go to sea at the end of the year. You get paid $800 less my, you know, what you owe me, of course.
So this is what you're essentially saying is you try to get rid of your parents by taking them to this place.
That's what I did. But they were
I need money for my wedding and my Lego.
But it's like, it's basically all these con artists and everything they do. It was really interesting. But one of my favorite parts of the tour is that it starts by this building that is now, like, the city block that's now a gentleman's club and all these other things. And he's explaining that when it was owned by this guy named Gus, and Gus wanted to make the premier destination for everybody who was off the trail and everything like that. So it was called
The Mouse from Cinderella, was it?
It was not.
Gus.
It was called the 9-Bar Saloon because there were 9 bars in it. One of which was a rectangular bar with a trough at waist height. So you could go and have a piss and a drink at the same time.
Wow.
It was a lot of really good stories, and the end of it was like, I need to learn more about Portland, because this is amazing.
Yeah, you found out about this after being here for 10 years. You're like,
I know.
Oh, yeah, that's fascinating, yeah.
The best con I learned about, actually, was by Governor Tom McCall, who's a beloved governor, and the reason why he's beloved is that he was pretty good to both sides of the fence. Like, he reached out to the hippy-dippies, and he reached out to the conservatives, and everybody liked him. He got along well with everybody because he played the game really well. But he found out that Nixon was coming to town, and he was like, and it was right before an election, too, and he was like, if I send in the National Guard, all the youth will be mad at me. If I don't do anything, the conservatives will be mad at me. What the heck am I going to do? So he threw a party. This was a year after Woodstock, so, like, through what was it called? I think it was called, like, Vortex One or something.
Yeah.
20 miles out of Portland, free food, free drink, like, bands and everything, and they're like, oh, you know, I heard that all these bands are going to be there, you know, Santana's going to be there, none of them showed up, and, but he's like, yeah, it's a free party and everything, and he got all the student groups to organize it and everything like that, and they're basically like, we're going to have police outside just if it gets violent, but otherwise, whatever happens in there stays in there, it's fine. And then I just so happened to be the week that Nixon was going to be in town. And so all of the kids who didn't go out to the event, he sent out the police to round up everybody with long hair or anybody who was driving a VW bus. And he directed the police, clearly these people are lost and you need to direct them either to the buses that are going out to Vortex 1 or guide them to Vortex 1 so that they can go have a good time.
So it essentially created a fun concentration camp for an evening.
Exactly. It was such a good idea. Nixon didn't wind up coming. He canceled at the last minute.
Just to distract a whole bunch of hippies for
exactly. Apparently the local press called it Operation Hippie Bait. It was pretty good. I learned about a lot of really smart cons this weekend.
That already sounds more interesting than House of Cards.
Exactly. So anyway, that's Annie's little Portland history interlude.
That's pretty cool. Are you gonna take your parents to Voodoo Donuts and then take them out to the parking lot, look in the window, go fuck this shit, we're going to Blue Star?
No, we did. The tour did go by Voodoo Donuts though, actually, and I didn't know. Bill, did you know the movie theater, the adult theater right next to Voodoo Donuts, now only plays hentai?
Oh, you. What?
They're a hentai theater now. Did you know this?
Like, all the programming?
It's hentai, yeah.
Why would you go...
Well, that I guess was like, anything.
So it's essentially a porno, but like just specifically hentai?
Yeah, a hentai porno theater.
I'm assuming that's for older people who don't know how to connect to the internet.
Well, what's funny is that, so this tour is me, my mom and my dad, and these, yeah. this older couple from Denver. That's this group. And tour guide, we're walking by this, and he's like, because it's technically like literally pretty much the center of Portland.
Yeah.
Proper. And he looks at us and he goes, do any of y'all know what hentai is? And
the tour guide asked this?
It's the tour guide. Because we were talking about salacious Portland history. And yeah. It's funny because my mom goes, I know what hentai is. And I'm just looking at my mother and she's like, I went down a corner of the internet that I should not have gone down.
Oh my god.
I think that Denver couple still doesn't know what hentai is, and I'm okay with that. I'll just say that. So. Anyway,
yeah.
Portland, Oregon. Okay, anyway, meanwhile, Blizzard announced that after 7 years, they've ceased development on their next MMO, codenamed Project Titan. Supposedly, it was quite a bit like Destiny, which might explain why it was suddenly kiboshed. Bill, tell me about Project Titan.
I'm sorry, I just want to look, I just did a Google image search for hentai just to see what the first, like, if you're just a random person, you just type in hentai just to see what comes up. And mm-hmm. yeah, it actually seems to be mostly furry hentai that I just saw. Anyway. Yeah, so have you heard much about the Project Titan stuff over the years?
A little bit.
Yeah, it's just because they were making it sound like this was going to be their project that was supposed to eventually replace World of Warcraft, but they just mm-hmm. killed it. Granted, they're not going to kill it just like last week. I'm sure this is something that's been dead for a little while, but they just finally announced it this week. Because some people were saying, well, Destiny got such a lukewarm reaction, they must have canceled Project Titan as a result of that, because the games were so similar. And it's like, no, that's not how video games work.
Yeah.
And some people were like, oh, Destiny is so much like Titan that they must have... And it sounds like, if anything, they were more likely just because, like... when they found out what Destiny was supposed to be like a couple years ago, if the project already wasn't shaping up, and they found out like Bungie's essentially kind of doing something kind of similar, that may mm-hmm. have been enough to kibosh the project. Also, people pointed out, I guess the core group that was working on Titan, they have gone off and they've already started working on something else for like the last 2 years. So mm-hmm. even if whatever Project Titan was supposed to be at like 3 or 4 years ago, that is officially dead, but they've already been working on something else for already a couple years. So this is not like a recent thing. So they're already knee deep in some other kind of like possibly MMO project. So who the fuck knows? But yeah, is there a new thing? It's interesting to think that Blizzard was actually going to go through, because it sounds like Titan was going to be a shooting game. I don't know if it's supposed to be first person, but it was going to be multiplayer shooting, collecting loot, stuff like that. So instead of like World of Warcraft, which is, you know, like kind of third person, just kind of hack and slash, this is supposed to be more of an action game, but with like the role playing elements layered on top of it, like a lot like Destiny. In fact, actually, the scenario of you're like running around an Earth that has been wiped out by like an alien menace and stuff like that. Even the setting sounds like Destiny. So, but it's interesting that they decided not to do that. So, it's kind of funny that 7 years and they probably dropped probably hundreds of millions of dollars in that project. And it's funny that they're in a situation they can go, nah, this wasn't working. Something else already like this on the market. We're just going to do something else. So,
interesting. Oof. In other news, the alternate Marvel Milo Manara comic covers were canceled.
Woo!
So this is when these were the covers that everyone was losing their biscuits about, because it was, he's a erotic European comics artist, and he drew Spider-Woman in a way that was provocative and nonsensical, really.
Yeah, and you don't understand, like, he drew exactly Spider-Man exactly how you think you draw the Spider-Woman, right?
Yes.
Yeah. But he drew, you got a Milo Manara sketch. Yeah, like, essentially you got what you thought you were, like, this is one of those things with Marvel, you're like, what did you expect was going to happen with
it is what it says on the tin, you know?
It's a little, so it turns out one of his canceled covers that just got canceled was going to be for the second issue of the new Lady Thor series.
Really?
Oh, man, I can imagine what the fuck that was going to look like. I looked to see if, like, the images from that got leaked, but no, there doesn't seem to be anything that was like, oh, man, that would have been fucking rough. Did you see the new logo for the female Thor series?
No.
It's Thor. It's T and two, like, metal spikes with the handle of Thor's hammer crossed through the two spikes, so it says it makes an H. And the O is the actual hammer end of the of Thor's hammer, and then just says Or. Has the R at the end. It's very cute. It's a very clever Thor logo.
Oh.
But, yeah, fuck Milo Manara.
I still can't believe that I discovered him by accident.
Yeah, how did you? Oh, did you? You bought a book of his stuff at Excalibur, right?
Yeah, I didn't see it. I was like, oh, this looks. His stuff looks. I like the cover. I flipped through it. I was like, oh, it's like set in colonial or like puritanical America. That's kind of interesting.
Wasn't it something about a girl ends up like? Yeah, what was the story of that?
I can't even remember because I read it and I was like,
this you recited it to me, and I think it got like maybe kind of like I don't know, man. It sounded yeah, okay.
I discovered him in a very.
Well, most of the stuff I've seen from him, my actual first exposure to Milo Manara was back in the 80s. Like alternative comics I would read it would have ads on the back for he was doing a series called Click, which was the series about this guy who invents this machine that can like turn women on from a distance, like a little handheld like machine, the clicky machine with a dial on it, and you could point it to a lady and turn it up and it would like make her orgasm right there on the spot. And so that was my first experience. And it's funny thing, like here we are like 20 years later and it's like, oh, he's drawing Spider Woman. Like what?
Yep.
Anyway,
our world is a funny one, my friend.
Yeah.
Let's see. Truly the worst news ever, aside from the bit about the Millennium Falcon's radar dish, the whole LEGO Monster Fighters line, including the cool Haunted House, have been discontinued.
I was close this week. I went to the mountaintop of the volcano that we live nearby. And I was up on top of it for a moment, looking down, just like contemplating self-destruction when I found out about this. No, actually, yeah, so, which is really weird because, okay, so LEGO has this Monster Fighter series, which is all, like, Halloween monster stuff, you know, vampires and werewolves and stuff like that, mm-hmm. and I guess it was just introduced, like, maybe a year ago, and they just canceled mm-hmm. it, like, the month before Halloween, which yeah. is like, guys, what are you doing? I think you could have milked this for a month more. Like, you would have sold more if you just hung out for an extra month.
Well, A, they're an international corporation.
Oh, I know.
B, I got an email from, so I'm on the LEGO company email list. I got an email from them saying, Happy Halloween! Look at the seasonal item, and then, like, look at our seasonal items, and there was a picture of a model of a bat, and I clicked through to see any others, and that was it.
That was it. They had that a month ago. They had all those Monster Hunter stuff, and now it's like, poof. Yeah. Actually, I was so sad. I actually sent a letter off to LEGO customer service asking, like, is this just out of like temporarily out of stock? Because a lot of their stuff falls out of stock, and there'll be a thing on the website saying, well, we anticipate this being back in stock like in a month or something. Yeah. Like. And they were like, no, this is it. We canceled. We're not manufacturing this shit anymore. I was like, oh. Which, the month, we talked about this before on the podcast. The Haunted House was pretty cool, but neither of us are really into, the day-glow green bricks that most of the house was made out of. But it would have been a cool kit to take and kind of, like fix it up and kind of, like, custom.
Yeah. I should get it and then just replace all the parts with the non-green parts.
Well, okay, supposedly,
already on eBay for, like, $300.
According to the LEGO subreddit, supposedly there are copies of that, like, all, like, Walmart and stuff still has those on the shelves right now.
Yeah.
You just have, you can buy it at cost, but, like, it's just not being on the stores. But, like, if you move, like, in the next week or two, you can go out and find a copy of it. But, like, yeah. But, yeah. And still, they still have the Parisian restaurant in stock, though. That as long as they have that, that's all I care about. My dream is to, I think within the next couple weeks, I will buy a Parisian restaurant and the Star Wars Cantina and put the Star Wars Cantina people hanging out in the Parisian restaurant.
So I was watching the LEGO movie last night. It was my first time seeing it in a while, especially since getting so deep into LEGO.
Yeah.
There's one part where they're walking, where all the construction workers at the start of the movie are leaving the construction site, and they're talking about going out and hanging out, and they're talking about their favorite foods.
Chicken wings.
And the three foods they talk about are chicken wings, croissants, and giant sausages. And then I thought about it, like, because that's the only LEGO food.
Exactly. Well, then the commentary for the movie, that's what the creators are like. Yeah, the guys are like, that's the only food we can think of, so that's like their favorite food. And then the Parisian restaurant has the croissants, it has the chicken, it has all that food stuff. Yeah.
Pretty good. Anyway, yeah. Marvel has finally settled its dispute over the rights to the comic book characters Jack Kirby created for the company. The terms are undisclosed, unfortunately, but everyone seems to agree that Kirby's family had Marvel over a bucket and is probably walking away with enough money to build a small Scrooge McDuck money bin.
Which is funny, because that's also a Disney character, Marvel. I had no idea this was going to the Supreme Court.
Oh, I didn't know either.
Yeah. That's what happened. This was supposed to, this is the Kirby family is going to plead its case before the Supreme Court next week. And everyone agreed that, like, if the Kirby family had such a good enough argument to take this all to the Supreme Court, that, like, even if they lost, the PR would be such a disastrous to Marvel. Yeah. and Disney that, like, it was worth them paying whatever they needed to pay the Marvel family, or the Kirby family. So the terms are undisclosed. Marvel hasn't come out and said anything. It sounds like whatever deal struck that Marvel obviously gets to keep the trademark and copyright to all the characters, but, like, I guess they're just going to pay the Kirby family a shitload of money just to recompense. Pay them back for all the stuff, because he created the Hulk. People point out he created Groot. Mm-hmm. You know, it's hard for Marvel to plead poor man when the most popular character from the most popular movie that's been released that was made by Marvel this year is created by the guy who is at the center of this whole lawsuit and everything like that.
Yeah.
And so this has been a debate that's going on for ever since he died 20 years ago. So this is finally at an end. So this is one of the most famous comic book lawsuits out there that's finally kiboshed. So yeah, good for his family.
Are you sad now? You don't hear many stories where it's about comics people trying to get paid for the work they did that end happily for the comics creators.
And by end happily means his family didn't get paid until 20 years after he was dead, but at least beats the alternative of never getting paid at all, but
relatively happily, question mark?
Yeah, kind of not. The bad guy won in the distant end, but kind of like, oh man, so glad Mad Max won in that last Mad Max movie, but we're all already dead by then anyway, so what does it really matter to us?
Animatics for the 4 unfinished episodes of the Clone Wars TV series were released on StarWars.com this week.
Yeah, so there's a whole big thing about how Star Wars, the CGI Clone Wars cartoon that we were talking about before, they were gonna produce more episodes, but they got shut down halfway when, speaking of Marvel and Disney and stuff like that, when Lucas sold all the Star Wars stuff to Disney, Disney immediately shut down production of all the CGI cartoons, CGI Clone Wars cartoons they were working on. And so this week, StarWars.com posted animatics and story reels from 4 of those unfinished episodes. I guess they had, better part of a season's worth of episodes in the hopper. And so they might, I don't know, who knows, maybe over the course of, this season, they'll just keep on dropping, more and more, information about these episodes. Because there's, the Clone Wars, when it got shut down, it was coming to a head. It was pretty much, had filled in pretty much most of the gaps between, the second Star Wars prequel and the third that the show was supposed to fulfill. It was already getting close to there. It was going to have a natural end. And so it was getting to the point where there was going to be, it seemed like they were going to have, tying up stuff. Mm-hmm. And so it's kind of interesting to see that they're actually putting up, at least versions of these episodes so you can see what the canonical stories were supposed to be.
Yeah.
The fate of, going back, I was talking about how terrible the main character of the Clone Wars is, this brand new character they created named Ahsoka Tano. She was kind of annoying at the beginning, but she became really cool. Her fate in the cartoon is completely left in up in the air, and so I don't know if they'll actually explain what happened to her in these episodes that they're, half-finished episodes that they're leaking onto the internet, but interesting stuff, though.
Huh.
Cartoons.
And finally, oh man, yesterday,
Saturday. This is the heartbreaker.
September 27th, 2014. Reportedly marked the end of 50 years of Saturday morning cartoons in America, with the last broadcast of the CW's Vortex animation block, which, like all other Saturday morning cartoon programming, has been replaced with live-action programming for teens and adults.
Which, I never heard about this, but I guess Vortex was the last nationally broadcast cartoon Saturday morning cartoon block in existence, and yesterday was the last showing of it, so that ends. I actually had to look up the history of Saturday morning cartoons in America, and they started off in the mid-60s, so it's been almost exactly 50 years of continuous Saturday morning cartoons until yesterday.
Wow.
So next Saturday will be the first Saturday that in the United States there will not be a nationally broadcast Saturday morning cartoon.
That is crazy.
We're all going to die. Granted, there's cartoons all over the place. We're living in a world where we got cartoons shooting out of our asses 24 hours a day. But in terms of nationally broadcast cartoons, that's not a thing anymore. We do have entire cable networks devoted to cartoons. You can watch cartoons on iTunes and stuff like that. But Saturday morning cartoons, that's it. They also announced that all breakfast cereal is going to be set on fire now.
That's it.
It's been done. Officially outlawed. It's the only justification for that stuff ever existing was for Saturday mornings. But so when I went to bed last night, I was looking up old YouTube videos of, I don't know if they did this in the 90s when you were kind of growing up, but back in the 80s and even the late 70s, on Friday nights before networks would start their newest season of Saturday morning cartoons, they would have a Friday night preview of all the new cartoons.
Yeah, we talked about this in the past. I don't remember this from my time.
Yeah, because I think I think I pretty much grew up at the very height of the Saturday morning cartoon shit, where you had so many licensed cartoons. You had Rubik's Cube cartoons and like all ALF cartoons and shit. Like.
Yeah.
And one thing I saw last night was like from 1989. It was Perfect Strangers introducing like the new ABC Saturday morning cartoon block.
Yeah.
Jim Balky and his cousin Larry. Like, oh, these cartoons are so hilarious. Oh, look. Oh, but we also have Bugs Bunny. We have the Goonies and the Oldies and all the stuff. And I was like, oh, this looks terrible.
Oh, it's so sad.
How did my parents ever put up with me watching this shit when I was a kid? And the other thing I saw too was a Saturday morning cartoon preview show from Friday night of like 1983, where you have the cast of The Dukes of Hazzard and Scott Baio introducing a block of cartoons starring Mario and Donkey Kong before Mario became famous, Q-Bert, and Dungeons and Dragons. So this is like 1983 must have been like right when video games were becoming like big thing in the national consciousness, but before Nintendo became the big thing with its own console in America. But yeah, what were your favorite Saturday morning cartoons specifically? Saturday morning, not like Disney afternoon stuff, but
gosh, I can't remember, to be honest with you. I don't really like. I was so in the cult of cartoons. I remember waking up and watching them, but I just watched all of them.
Yeah,
nothing in particular stands out distinctly.
Well, it kind of the watching the Perfect Strangers Saturday morning cartoon preview. Because I see some people talk about how the Disney afternoon cartoons were some of their favorite Saturday morning cartoons, and I'm like, hey, that's wrong. Disney afternoon is Disney afternoon. It's in the name. It's Disney afternoon. Because that shit was syndicated afternoon cartoons that happened every day. But I guess they eventually, like Gummy Bears and DuckTales eventually became part of like national program, like Saturday morning cartoons.
Yes.
So I guess maybe some people, that's how they first experienced that. So I feel bad for yelling at people. Like, no, you labeled these cartoons incorrectly. My favorite cartoon was Turbo Teen. It was about a kid who would turn into a car when he got wet or angry?
Look, two very different things, Bill.
Look this up sometime on YouTube. It's a horrifying transformation sequence when he would turn into a car and other people would ride him and his mouth turns into like the grill and his hands turn into tires. I remember watching it as a kid just like wanting to throw up because it was so fucking grotesque. Yeah, there's a Rubik's Cube cartoon where there's a little alien Rubik's Cube flying around. There's the Dungeons & Dragons cartoon. Man, all that shit. Like, I remember like all the Bugs Bunny cartoons when they had like little Bugs Bunny programming block. And Saturday morning cartoons.
Yeah, man.
This is me just like, listeners, feel free to email us with your favorite Saturday morning cartoons. Unless you're Maxwell Motley who lives in the UK and they don't show cartoons. Because,
that's right.
Yeah. This is the other thing. Maxwell Motley, speaking of Saturday morning cartoons, we're discussing the difference in breakfast cereals between the United States and the UK. And we were looking at how the different names that United States breakfast cereal has in the UK. The UK does have Fruit Loops, but Fruit Loops are fucked up colors because the UK actually has standards in terms of like sugar and artificial flavors you can add to cereal. So the cereal is only half the sweet and is all the wrong colors. It's like this, instead of the bright, punky Fruit Loops colors, it's a bunch of like washed out like vegetable colors.
Yeah.
It looks gross as hell.
And on that note, friends, this was the Boy High Podcast. Perhaps you can visit us from your country, your native land, and tell us about your breakfast cereals. In the meanwhile, you can email us at howdy@boyhowdy.org. We are at Boy Howdy Podcast on the Twitters, if so inclined. You can review us on iTunes if you do that sort of thing. And we will talk to y'all next week about more breakfast foods and cartoon shows that we miss.
Undoubtedly. Take care, guys.
All right, see y'all later, friends.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to stop recording.
All right, my friend, I will send you the MP3.
Yeah, so what are you guys up to today?
That is what I'm about to find out. I know that we have to go grocery shopping urgently.
Get cheap groceries?
Well, my parents are going to Costco, so we're going to go get some bulk toilet paper.
Man, what kind of toilet paper do you guys buy?
Whatever toilet paper. We're not...
You know what? I used to be exactly the same. I found a thing for, like, this Instacart stuff will deliver free groceries, so I actually had Costco delivered to my house. I had toilet paper, I sprung for the Charmin, And compared to, like, the other random toilet papers I've been using for, like, the last decade, Charmin is, like, you feel more civilized. Charmin is so thick and, like, just, like, it's like wiping your ass with a cloud. It's like, oh.
Nice toilet paper is good, my friend.
I know you're broke right now, but if you want to, like, if you want to treat yourself in the most unexpected ways at the most unexpected times of days, I'm just saying, just, it's like, oh.
I went into a restaurant in town that had a bidet in it, and it was
you actually used it?
Yeah. It was so pleasant that I was like, man, we gotta get a bidet up in here. I did research and everything, and I was like, I can't justify having a power cable stretching across my bathroom.
Is this Burger King on 50th and Foster?
Does that have a bidet in it?
I was hoping it would be.
No.
What was the restaurant?
There's a sushi place on Division that has
I gotta go.
Bidet in it.
Yeah. Could you just get a squirt gun?
It's more or less the same thing.
Okay, I'm glad you washed your bits then. No, that sounds even better than okay, in lieu of Charmin. I mean, treat your parents. They're gonna be using your bathroom too. Come on.
Literally, as as we're talking about this, I refreshed my Twitter feed so I could read it when we're done and saved you a click. Just did retweeted Slate saying, Americans need to drastically rethink the way we clean our butts, and saved you a click notes bidets. So I'm glad we're all of the alignment on this.
But doesn't bidets wash waste water?
Yes.
Although global warming melting the ice caps, that means that's more fresh water available to us that should be pumped right into bidets.
Clearly, yeah. You know,
or as the oceans rise, we just dunk our butts in the fresh water that is rising up around our house.
That's excellent. Yeah. Excellent, Bill. Aww. Fresh butt dumping. I'm on board.
You ever just buy a toothbrush for your butt just in case?
And Bill, I'll talk to you next week, my friend. No, I just emailed y'all about doing dinner on either Monday or Tuesday.
Okay, so. Super cool. I'm supposed to be doing something on one of those nights, so I'll get back in touch with you about that stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I make commitments to dinner stuff, but yeah, I'll figure out what's going on.
You're allowed. Stuff. My friend, I will send you an MP3.
It would be cool to see your folks.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll talk to you later then.
Bye, Bill.
Tell your folks I said hi.
Can do.
Oh, okay.